What's up, guys? It's your man Donovan Sharp, and welcome to this edition of One-on-One with Donovan Sharp. I haven't been in here in a while. The last guest I had in here was Minister Japp, and that was, what was that, like a month ago, Dev? Like three weeks, a month ago, something like that? So it's been a while since we've been in here, but we are here now, and we, of course, are joined by the one and only Captain Capitalism, a.k.a. Aaron Clary, a.k.a. Cappy. How's it going, man?
It's going great.
Now, you walked here from the hotel.
Yeah.
Like, you walk. That's like a three-mile walk, dude. Yeah. Unbelievable.
It's beautiful out there, though.
Oh, my God, Jesus Christ.
Didn't you have snow, like, a month ago or a week ago or something?
Yeah, something like that. See, this is why you look like that, and I've got, like, I'm working on some B-cups. I lost almost 25 pounds during the quarantine because I have a home gym. Got into phenomenal shape. Yeah. Then I started doing the one-on-ones with Donovan Sharps. What do you notice about each one of these photos?
They're all very good-looking men.
Yes,
yeah,
right.
There might be food involved.
Yes. So, like, and listen, I mean, it is what it is. But, yeah, like, I mean, dude, we're steak and potatoes and then cheesecake at the end because I can't really resist that. And a lot of my progress has been stripped from me, but thankfully, you know, my midsection is really the only place I gain weight, so hopefully I can get these tatas down over the holidays. And
you want to walk to the restaurant?
No, we're definitely not walking to the restaurant. Absolutely not. real quick, I want to give a special shout out, a special thank you to the Marfuki man, Matthew H, the Marfuki man. For this table, I hadn't been to the studio in a while, and I got here this morning, and it was you know, nice FedEx package. Dude, it is a blue resin it's a blue resin coffee table. He sent it right here, and you know what's interesting? This is weird how my mind thinks, man, and maybe it's just because I'm weird, but I was actually thinking, okay, I put my ear up to the box to make sure it wasn't maybe, and I was like, no, he wouldn't do that. But yeah, man, I mean, this is fantastic, man. He did this all himself. He made this by himself. He shipped it out here to Sharp Studio, Studio B. So a big thanks goes out to Marfuki, man, Matt H, for doing this, man. I greatly, greatly appreciate that. Okay, so every time I put the word out that I have XYZ guest coming on, you are the guest that by far, the two guests that get the most questions are this guy, Kevin Samuels, and you. And guys are, I think what a lot of guys fail to understand, and it's not, I don't think it's a deficiency on their part, but when most men come to find this community because of sexual frustration, heartbreak, or both, right? We read, you know, Rouge V and Illimitable Man and Rolla Tomasi because we want to get better with girls. Well, okay, so you achieve all that, and then you want to live this red pill life, but there's always one element that kind of gets left by the wayside, and that is money management.
Right.
Money management quite literally makes and breaks people. So in your opinion, why is it that men who are out, like, I'm 43 years old and I'm just now starting to figure out how to manage money, balance my budget, et cetera, et cetera. Why are guys like me such late bloomers when it comes to this stuff?
It's probably because you didn't have money, because that's what happened to me. And I studied finance in college because I wanted to not be poor anymore.
Sure,
so it logically made sense to a young 17-year-old Aaron to do that. But for the most part, we're too busy just getting by.
Okay.
Just putting food, clothing, and shelter. What's that?
Yeah, talking at the top of the mic.
It's,
you can actually tilt that back.
I can't. All right.
Yeah, there you go.
It really is just getting food, clothing, and shelter. It's Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So it's not like, oh, I can invest in my 401k when I'm 22. It's like, no, you probably have student loan debts for a degree of dubious value.
Oh my God.
And you have no disposable income. And so if all your income is going to just surviving, it's not until you are in your 40s or your late 30s, and heaven forbid you don't have a financial crisis or a dot-com bubble, hits everybody back to zero.
Sure.
So that's why it's delayed, is because in order to save for retirement or get a down payment on the house, you first need the money. And so for, I'd say, at least half the population, especially now that we've started burdening people with going to college, with a huge amount of college debt and college loans, that negates having expendable income to go ahead and save. And then I would also say in general, slowing economic growth. It's not like the booming 50s or the 60s where economic growth was about twice of what it is long term, right now.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, there's definitely some hurdles. And you're saying, well, why aren't men good with money? It's like, well, you need money to be good with in the first place.
Right,
and
right.
so that's the primary thing is people just go to school longer, don't have money for longer. It's not until in your 30s, really, does the average guy start having money to do something with.
You mentioned college, and something that I didn't foresee when I was in college. I didn't finish college. I went to college for, 2.5 years? Mm-hmm. And I was like, you know what? I don't really know what I want to do with my life. So that was it. I just left.
That's smart.
You know, and fortunately enough, I didn't have as much crushing student debt. And that's the one great regret in my life. I graduated in 95. The one regret that I have in my life that, and I don't really regret much, to be honest with you. I don't think there's anything that I've done or didn't do where I'm like, man, if I had only done that. There are some things that I'd say, could I have done that a little differently? Okay, probably, but I'm not mad that it happened. I should have joined the military right out of high school. Right. That's what I should have done. I think that would have spared me. I think that would have really, really flattened out my learning curve in terms of learning about life, about people, about men, about women.
Discipline.
Yeah. Goodness gracious. And I'm this insanely disciplined person. You and I were talking off the air. You're like, how many hours a week are you working? I'm working at least 90 hours a week. I wasn't like that in my 20s. Mm-hmm. In my 20s, I just said, hey, man, if I can make $500,000 one time, then I'll be set for the next 10 years. Yeah, that's it. But now it's the more money I make, the more money I want to make. And I think that just comes with growth and maturity. I think people just kind of grow out of that phase. What are your thoughts?
Well, you can look back at armchair quarterback all you want.
Right.
You got to understand what you were going into life. And most of us were not maliciously lied to, but certainly misinformed about the value of a college degree, what to study. Sure, in 1965, when tuition was $1.25 per decade, whatever the boomers paid.
right.
And you know, any degree was a good degree because less than 10% of the population had a degree. Yeah. But the misinformation we're given about investing your time and getting education. It was wrong.
Yes,
it wasn't necessarily a lie, but it didn't help us out. So that is, you kind of got to forgive yourself for that much. But then going forward, like when you make money, you also start getting the work ethic. I may have a slightly different opinion, but if I made $500,000, you'd never see me again. I would be gone.
Yeah, this is you.
Get out of here.
Oh, my God. Yeah, listen, 500 grand in your pocket right now, and you, a guy like you, are set for life, man.
You might see a podcast a year, maybe a book. I'd be fishing and riding motorcycle across Asia. I wouldn't. But at the same time, what I think it really is, especially as men get older, and we get the testosterone out of our system, or we settle down, you really start to ask, okay, what do I want to do in life?
Yeah.
And you would have kids normally, or a career or profession. That is less and less so the case because of the risks or the impossibility. I mean, I remember probably you remember all those Wall Street movies in the 80s?
Oh, yeah.
Everything like Wall Street.
Oh, yeah. Or become Greed is good. Yeah.
Or go become a cop.
Yeah,
in L.A. because of Lethal Weapon. You know,
or a New York lawyer or something like
right,
that.
Right, yeah. Right. So... You have this, I'm going to go have this dream I'm going to have. But once you get past those dreams, once you find out what's real, especially in today's world, what economic opportunities are out there, a man has to do something. He can't, you know, if you don't have kids, you don't have a career, well then, like this, it ends up becoming entrepreneurship. Your side gig ends up becoming your main hustle.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's like an addiction to money or greed. It's just, that's the best game in town now.
Right.
And especially, it's... Chasing girls, that was the ultimate game. Because to play, you get to watch the younger guys fumble and make horrible, painful messes of it. Like, oh, the quarterback gets sacked. Oh, I remember I did that. So you could look back at it, but then it's not that you're greedy or wanting to make the money. It's just it gives you some kind of purpose and agency.
Yeah,
and look at this. I mean, this is you know, I talk about it's not so much how much money do we make or how many followers and stuff. It's your legacy. Like when you are dead... You're going to be remembered, and your influence will go on beyond that. I got my books and things like that. So I think that is a goal that most men can have, a goal most men are going to fall into.
Yeah.
And if you make some bucks along the way, cool. But I wouldn't necessarily say, oh, yeah, we got to make more money. You get addicted to making money.
You know, it's interesting. I had a slight blow up on the air last Saturday. because one of my patrons, he was a patron of mine for 10, 15 minutes, and he decided that he didn't want to be patron anymore. Okay. But on his way out, he called me a gold digger. And I took, I knew I shouldn't have read it on the air.
Is this that stoicism thing?
Oh, my God, dude. Like, yeah, the debacle at the airline. Dude, you should, oh, my God. It was, and I was lifting weights at the time, so I'm throwing stuff around. But this is a different situation. But the fact that this guy called me a gold digger, I was so, like, I was pissed because, no, number one, nobody works for free. And I think most people would admit that. And I think the only time people really have a problem with people charging for their knowledge is when they want the knowledge you have. No one calls Emeril Lagasse a crook or a gold digger for selling his, you know, pressure cooker steamer. Mm. Nobody calls Cesar Millan a gold digger because he has books and courses on how to train your dog better.
Right.
No, but there are guys who call us gold diggers and you know, we're money hungry because the information that we provide is the information that they want, and they don't want to pay for it, right? And if they don't want to pay for it, that's fine. There's plenty of free stuff. But what you just said is absolutely the reason I'm doing this. Most people in this lifetime, Aaron, most people know more people than people know about them. You know what I mean? So if so the average person right. probably knows 250 people, mm-hmm. maybe 500 people know of them, mm-hmm. right? I can be one of the very few people when I die, when I leave this earth, whatever, however it happens, that's my legacy. When people look back on Donovan Sharp, you can love him or hate him, but this dude made a difference. Mm. Many more people will know of me than I ever knew. And that's one of the main reasons I do this, is to help people and to build a legacy.
Mm-hmm. It's not even popularity.
No,
It's not like, ooh, yay, how many followers? They're not like these, you know, these girls on the Instagram or
yeah, right.
friends only or whatever.
and
let's be also very pro. This totally happened by accident. It wasn't like you and I woke up, you know what I'm going to do at 1997? I'm going to take advantage of this here internet thing and go booty boobity bobbity boo on the internet and people just give me money.
Oh my God, it's incredible.
It was a complete accident and a path where we probably did it as I hate to use this word because it's so abused, but it was a genuine passion or a hobby or something we like to do. Yes. I started by writing, and then people naturally gravitate. And what ended up making this a reality is bandwidth.
Of course.
We'd still be writing text and blogs, and that's fine.
Right.
And there'd be books, but you know, this entire world we got going on here with all this, you know, all streaming live, you know, that's only because of bandwidth.
Right.
And
right.
just certain people happen to have it at the right place at the right time, right. with the right skill set, right. or just the right personality.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I don't know about you. I enjoyed working security. Okay.
Okay.
I had some great friends, great colleagues. You know, it was like a team of brothers I never had.
Right.
But I don't ever have to patrol in 20 below zero for $6.90 an hour ever again. And I'm going to take the money.
Right.
I'm going to, so that you don't have to go patrol for $6.90 or $12 an hour adjusted for inflation. Patrolling and being cold and being poor and being hungry. You know, it's like, I am going to charge money for it. I'm going to tell you my boring stories about working security. And, you know what? If people want to pay and buy and there you go. But yeah, I don't know. I just, like, we've had our conversation before. Like, you know, you had anger issues and I had anger issues, and it's really hard to get. So, man, it's tough. Do not care, like, if someone calls me the gold digger or if someone, and it's like, okay, fine, go.
Then
don't buy it. Like,
I love it when guys announce when they leave, right? I love when they, like, when people, I'm leaving because of blah, 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 blah. And again, that's the chink in the armor. And one of these days, I am going to get it. I'm going to have to do something about it. The way I deal with it now is I just explained to you, we were talking about this off the air. Mm-hmm. I got to put my chat behind a paywall now because right. I got Yahoo's in here trying to hijack the chat and do all this other kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But something else you said, 100% true. This is all an accident. The reason Donovan Sharp, I actually started off, we both wrote for Return of Kings for a good while.
Right. Yeah, well,
and I had started out as sharpshooter. I was at the height of my powers in Las Vegas, and I was like, holy shit, like, there's a community of guys who share stories with articles. I got in contact with Rouge, and next thing you know, I'm starting to write for Return of Kings. Mm-hmm. He was paying me, What was he paid? Yeah. He paid.
I just did it for free.
Well, this was because I was a weekly columnist, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
So I
you had responsibility.
Of course, absolutely. And so what I began to and I've always been an exceptional writer and an exceptional speaker, but I never thought, you know what, I'm gonna do a podcast. No, I gained a lot of popularity with Return of Kings. And here's the thing. I remember when my name went from Sharpshooter to Donovan Sharp, Rouge sent an email out to everybody and said, hey, we got guys who call themselves Toothmosis, right? Or Runs on Magic. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, he says, listen, make up a pseudonym, but make it realistic, right? First and last name. So Donovan Sharp. That sounds good enough. And that is how Donovan Sharp was created. I didn't think about doing a podcast until somebody in the comments of Return of King says, hey, man, you might want to start a podcast. This, right? And it was 1 year after that. That's when I first, you know, put it on SoundCloud. The rest is history, mm-hmm. man. It was total luck, man.
And I think, especially because you have predominantly a younger male audience, I presume, kind of looking in some, everything I tried to be good at professionally, I wouldn't say I failed, but I did not excel in.
Right.
Because of reasons outside of my control. And what's going to happen in life? Because of circumstances outside of your control, life is going to tell you what you're good at. And it is key you listen. For the longest time, I want to be in banking. I wasn't banking, but you know what I was way better at? And it was completely on a lark, just a little side thing to do.
What's that?
Teaching ballroom dance. And then that sent me down the path of entrepreneurship because it's a 1099 thing. You're not employed by anyone. You go and you got to get your skills up. And teaching ballroom dance in the Twin Cities, across Minnesota, actually. Learning about, if I learn these dances, I can teach three at a time. So instead of driving there for 1 hour to teach and then back, I could go out there, get three clap per trip, da-da-da. All the marketing and selling instructional dance DVDs hair down here and I was young and pretty.
Wow.
And also it kind of opens your mind, but you have to be one paying attention to when the world's trying to tell you you suck at something. Maybe it's not you that sucks, but you're just not cut out for this world.
Right.
Because the industry could be corrupt or the industry could just not be your personality. But yeah, then all of a sudden you'll be like, oh, teach a dance class? Sure, I guess. And all of a sudden you're making, and so you really gotta experiment, try different things, you know, and I don't know if I told you this, but you know I flunked out of seventh grade English, right?
No, I did not.
Yeah, I'm an author. I've written more books than all my English teachers combined.
Right, of course.
Yeah,
of course.
I mean, but they never write books. But it's amazing where it's just like, if you feel like doing something, again, I hate to use the P word, but you have a genuine passion about it, don't make your career out of it. Go make a hobby out of it.
There you go.
Certainly along the way, there might be some way to make money. And then you'll have a nice studio and you'll get to hang out with, you know, legit celebrities.
Hey, can you put that on silent for me? Thank you. Thank you. Now, I'm going to read off some super chats here. But before I do that, man, you are a fascinating guy. And it's interesting. I think a lot of people aptly compare you to Joker. Joker.
Wait, the YouTuber?
Listen, well, think about this. Joker's been around the world. He worked at a gentleman's club for 5 years. He's got tattoos from
military.
He's in the military. You are much the same way. You know, you taught ballroom dance. Dude, you've traveled all around the country. You're on your motorcycle smoking cigars. You're living the life that our audience wants to live. Like, you are that guy. What's the genesis of Aaron Clare? Give us sort of a Reader's Digest version. How
poverty.
Did you
poverty?
Oh, is that what it is? Okay, all right.
Being poor. That's we didn't grow up in absolute poverty. We're lower middle income.
Right.
But there was no money for college.
Right.
None.
Right.
And so then you go there, and I remember I entered my freshman year at 147 pounds. By the time my freshman year ended, I was down to 118 because of all the patrolling and lack of food.
Shit.
And so that will drive you. You want to end poverty? Be poor.
That's right.
You know, you get poor and have no backup. It's like, we got to get out of here, and we're the only ones going to get out of here.
That's right.
And so that is what drove me. And then what ended up getting... and. I define success as freedom.
Okay.
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 And we've had our talk about money versus time.
Yes.
There really is no such thing as money. There's only time, and that's the only resource you got.
Right, right.
And I'd like to have $1 million, but I hated school. Dad was a pastor. Hated going to church. Hate going to college. Hate having you, because you're not free.
Right.
And so it was the poverty, plus the yearning to be free that I'm just like, I want to make as much money as possible. And the quickest way to make the most amount of money that you need, or the money you need, is to not need that much money at all.
Okay.
And so poverty forced minimalism on me.
Oh,
and not wow. By, you know, yeah, I'd love to. Do you know I never ordered a pizza in college? Not once. Couldn't afford it.
Okay, you're one of one person that has never ordered a pizza in college.
Okay.
Like, you're the only one. Yeah, you know. That's incredible.
I remember it even got bad enough. Like, there's a place called Perry's Pizza. It's no longer there. And, like, I would, like, if my friends went there, I'd go on patrol. Like, hey, what's going on, guys? And if they wouldn't finish their pizza, I'd, like, finish their crust and things like that. It was that bad. Sub Mike's, they had, like, day-old bread for 50 cents. You just get this footwork.
Sure, sure.
So when it's forced on you, you start to realize you don't need what society is telling you. You don't need your Ferrari. Okay. You don't need your sweet pad. You don't need, I desperately wanted video games. I desperately wanted the PlayStation. I couldn't
resist that. Couldn't get around that.
Right. You know, I'd like to eat, you know, good food. And when Subway came out with the $5 footlongs, I thought,
oh, that's it. The world. Yes. That was just, yes.
So it, and then, but although it sucked, here's the ultimate awesome benefit of it. I realized I didn't need fancy things. Like, the Mall of America was relatively new in the Twin Cities when I went to college. Yeah. And so you go in there, and here's this cathedral of capitalism with all the material things you could ever want and never even thought of, like sharper image. I guess I need a foot-rubbing toilet. Sure. Yes. Well, all right. Okay. That pipes music in.
Right.
I realized I don't need any of that stuff. You need food, clothing, and shelter. And that was it. And so once the hurdle is that low, you don't have to make that much money. Hmm. And then I've always lived in a duplex or with a roommate situation.
Yeah.
I've always rented out other rooms, saved up my money, finally paid off my house when I was 42. And dude, when you don't have to pay for lodging, then
you don't need nothing to get by.
And so once if you have no debts, you have no car loans, you could fix your own car, you could fix your own motorcycle, you have no student debts, you have a reason, you don't need much money. And so that's why, you know, then, well, what do you do? Well, now you have time. Time is your richness.
That's right.
And so now it's drive my motorcycle there to Alaska, go out to Vegas and do hiking, come hang out with you, go for a nice walk on a nice day. And so that's the genesis.
Wow, I did not know that about you. Interestingly enough, we plan to move out to Reno next summer, it's gonna be awesome. I'm trying to buy property out there. I don't want a mortgage when I go out there. I want to put my cash on the table. I want the deed. Like, to me, that's the only way to do it. I know that there are financial benefits to mortgages and all that other kind of stuff, but I don't like payments, man. I financed one car in my life. That was when I was 19 years old. It was a 1993 Nissan Sentra. I hated paying that $211 every month, man. I hated it.
Yeah.
So when I was 25 years old, I bought it was like a 1998 Mitsubishi Galant. I bought it for like $4,500. The guy gave me the pink slips. I was like, this is what I'm talking about.
It's a feeling like it's better than crack, man.
My insurance was $3 a month. It was incredible. It was incredible. Okay. So, let me read a couple super chats here. Then we'll get to the questions, my viewers had for you. Nonstop Dre 360, $2 says the brave and stunning thought leader, Aaron Clary.
He's this Hanyaker. He's a good guy.
He's funny, isn't he?
Yeah. He follows me. Do you know Dre?
Oh, yeah. Okay. He's in my chat all the time, man. Seeker of Truth, $5 says just tuning in. Altham Adeluca.
That's Atham.
Atham.
He'll be your buddy in Reno. He lives out in that area.
Okay.
Yep.
He says, yo, say hi to Aaron Clary, El Chaparito.
Oh, yes. I'm the short man.
The short man. Yeah, yes. You're really not that short. What are you, 5'9"? Yeah, you're not that short, man.
Are you kidding? That's like short for now.
I don't know. You look taller than you are, because I'm 6'2".
Yeah.
Yeah.
Were you expecting me to be like a midget?
I guess.
Maybe because you had Rolo here. That's what you thought.
Rolo is taller than I thought.
Is he taller than
you? Rolo is 6'1". Dude, I look him right in the eye. Rouge is 6'2".
You are kidding.
Not kidding.
I thought he was a little guy.
Nope. Dude, look at that picture.
Well,
it looks like, for whatever reason, it looks like I'm 6'2", so I'm taller than him, but not by much.
That's why he doesn't want
to. He's a tall drink of water, man.
I thought he was shorter than me.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Rouge V, that dude is 6'2". Look. That's right next to me.
Okay,
and the reason I look short is because I'm doing the beta thing by tilting in, which I should not have done. Jesus Christ.
You should take Modern Life's John's Body Mage, Mastery
Language. Yes, Body Language Mastery, MLD.
He'll touch that up.
By that today. Red Pill Mike, $100 super chat. He says, I can't wrap my head around the idea of someone thinking that Donovan Sharp is a gold digger. I watch a show regularly, and I've never thought that guy looks just like the kind of woman I always avoid. People will always be idiots no matter what happens. Yeah, dude, that like hurt me to my core, man.
Why would you care? Here, I mean, because of all the things, you got everything kind of set up. Things are going well now. And I know it's hard not to put them up, but what, like, for example, we're driving to go get the rental car.
Yeah.
Guy cuts off, and my buddy who was driving is like, oh, I'm like, what? Come on. What? It's going to happen. Why? What? The day is coming that there isn't going to be someone who's bothering you.
You're right.
The day is coming someone isn't going to say something on the internet that perturbs you. And I just
And I'm not, I'm not subjected to it a whole lot because everything's behind a paywall.
Right.
But every once in a while, somebody gets behind that paywall and they,
well, they think kinda, about this. Did they have to pay you?
They did. Okay. They did. Well, I made, actually, I gave them a refund, actually.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
So.
Well, here's, for example, I don't know, it's a bit more obscure in geek culture. This kid called Chris Beckloff. He's actually in Pennsylvania as well.
Oh, okay.
And so some guy would just send chats in to curse and swear at him, call him names.
Wow.
He didn't care. He's like, fine, you can call me names all day.
You're paying me for it.
Pay me for it.
You're paying me for it. Yeah, again, I think it's because. I think it's because I know why I started doing this and I know what my end game is. And I know people who do what you and I do who are not who they appear to be. They are absolutely snake oil salespeople. A lot of these guys parrot what we say, right? Like, I used to have dudes, I mean, I've seen dudes in other people's chats and my chats. They'll be in my chat for about a year, then they start a channel. Mm. And then everything they talk about is exactly, I don't go after those guys, but I am who I am through and through. And I just do not like it when people accuse me of not being genuine. But, I mean, it's just something that's going to be inevitable. So.
My friends call me gay all the time and all these other slurs. Oh, I don't think I am.
So. I don't think you are either. Okay, so I'm going to read off some questions here for you. So Andrew S., one of my patrons, says, what do you think of Dave Ramsey's baby steps? And I actually have a list of them right here. Dave Ramsey's 7 baby steps to financial success. Step number 1, save $1,000 for your starter emergency fund. Mm-hmm. Step 2, pay off all debt except the house using the debt snowball. Number 3, save 3 to 6 months of expenses in fully funded emergency fund. Step 4, invest 15% of your household income in retirement. Step 5, save for your children's college fund. Step 6, pay off your home early. Step 7, build wealth and give. Those are 7 baby steps to financial success. What are your thoughts on that?
I like it. Someone paid me to do a review of it, and I forgot exactly what I said because I'd have to remember. But
so you've heard of this before?
Oh yeah, no, over on my consultancy, someone paid me to do a review of it.
Wow,
but and so you get, if you search my channel, you'll find a more full answer than what I'm prepared to give now.
Okay,
but I like it because you do need an emergency fund if for any other reason, so you are not at the mercy of not necessarily emergencies, but what is much more likely to happen, a psychotic, psychopathic boss, an abusive boss. I'd say you want to get 3 months savings so the day you walk into a job and there's effery going on and there's BS and you were lied to or the job description, you walk.
Yeah.
And you're not, that's where you have to stay there. Now that's on your employment record.
Yeah.
And I fell into this trap where you go from bad boss to bad boss to bad boss.
Really?
Yeah. Because they would, you get one bad boss by needing money. And I was so desperate to pay off my house. I didn't have 3 to 6 months of living expenses.
Right.
So $1,000 emergency fund for genuine emergencies. Sure. What's the second one then?
Number 2, pay off all debt except for the house using the debt snowball.
I would debate that. I would get a 3 to 6 months emergency. I would stay current on your credit card bills.
Sure.
You know, if you have a credit card charging 24% interest, consolidate somehow so you can get it all under one low payment.
Like you got a house to a home. Man.
Well, it's out there. I mean, and cars are sometimes that too.
If
you're signing. So I would get 3 to 6 months emergency reserve so that then you can now, if anyone screws with you at work, you can leave.
You can bounce.
Or if they now pay you enough,
ooh,
you can hold out for more. And so the quickest way to increase your wage is when you don't need it. So if someone right. when someone says like, oh, well, we'll pay you 40 grand a year. I'm like, eh, no, that's all right. Whoa, hang on. Wait. And then.
Yeah. Now they're 60, 65.
Now they're 60, 65. Right. So I cannot emphasize that 3 to 6 months cushion enough.
Okay.
Then I would tackle your debt, but I triage it with credit card debt or whatever the highest interest bearing debt you have. Mm-hmm. If you have student loan debt or a mortgage, well, hold on there. You also want to throw some money into investments like okay. 401k, IRA, and especially so, I'd say this is even before you pay off your credit card debts, is if you get a match at work through a 401k, oh. that's free money.
Yeah, yes, it is.
That's number two. You get your freedom fund, you get a 401k match up to the match, your high interest credit cards, but once you get down, you know, your mortgage and maybe your student loans, then I'd split it between investing in a stock market,
okay.
a mutual fund, well-diversified portfolio, and then an abatement plan paying down your loans.
Okay.
and then I would honestly...
College fund, pay off home early?
I would not do a college fund. I would not pay your kids' way through college.
Okay.
What I would do really with kids and their education, you start them young. There's no reason an eighth grader can't learn calculus. There's no reason an eighth grader can't go to school online, get accredited. College tuition. There's no reason you can't have your wow. kid have a college degree by the age of 18 and have it be on the cheap. And I think,
how would you do that? That's fascinating.
Homeschool. School. Did you enjoy school?
I did.
What?
I did.
What? You have glasses or something?
Yeah, I had corrective lenses. I think I enjoyed school just because I liked hanging out with my friends. I think that's okay. probably why.
Okay.
But listen, sitting in the classroom, teachers, Ms. Hiranaka, Mr. Matsu, like nobody wants to. Yeah,
Appomattox right. Courthouse,
Partisan. For crying out loud.
Dude, yeah. You're starting in the eighth grade. I'm not saying kids got to have a doctorate in nuclear engineering okay. by the time they're okay. they're 18, but at minimum, you should have your prereqs knocked out and okay. an associates. And wow. and your kid may not even want to know. They're what are you, 13, 14 at the eighth grade?
Right.
They don't know what you want to do, but sit down and start figuring out what you want to do.
Okay.
And there's, you know, homeschool, whatever. I had a client, she was an immigrant, and she contacted me for different reasons, but I was so proud of her because she followed my advice before. She dropped out of high school, got her GED, went to college.
Wow.
At 15.
Whoa.
And then like got accounting.
Holy
or like,
God, man.
And because high school is frankly pointless. Yeah. You don't need it. You can skip it.
The first 2 years of college is literally high school review.
Yeah. And so why force yourself to study 2-3 times you take AP classes? Why did I take calculus in high school when I had to retake it in college? Why did I take statistics when I had, why did I take economics? Did the same thing. Forget it. Education, well, rather I should say, knowledge is free.
Right.
Okay, we have the internet. Education should be free. We should have certifications and credentials where you take a test. Here's your degree.
Okay.
Not, you sit here and pay this person $500
right.
a credit.
Right.
But the best thing we can do right now is, if you want your kids to prepare for their college, mm-hmm. is you get them into an online school or the local community college. We're going to learn calculus. You sit down with them. You make sure this presumes you invest time in your children so they're mature enough to go to college in the eighth grade or take online classes. You knock out your psychology, your economic, your 101s. You knock them out.
Right.
So then your kid, if they do go to college, like a real college, or maybe it's only 2 years. They go to the main campus to get whatever, their engineering degree or their actuarial science
they're out
degree.
Of there.
And then they're out of there at 20. They can't even drink. And they're
now I got a degree before I could even drink.
Right, you get a degree, and then they get a $60,000 a year job offer as an actuary, because they assume you're 22.
Of course.
So that's what I would do there. And then
Paying off the home early?
Pay off the home early, but I would also, this is why I wrote Reconnaissance Man, it's very important.
Oh, by the way, Debs, she's read all your books.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, she's read them all. Dude, Bachelor Pad Economics, the Reconnaissance. Oh, what?
So anyway, Reconnaissance Man, it's not necessarily sexy, but it's very important because if you buy, I don't know what the average person buys, but 3 houses over the course of their lives, that's 21% of the housing value paid to realtors.
Wow.
And there's moving costs. And to be perfectly honest, unless you have a lot of kids, you probably have more house than you need.
Yes.
So why don't everybody, we're in the Northeast, right?
Yeah.
Why are you people living here? You all end up in Florida anyway. Right. Why don't you, out of high school, you all go down to Florida, you buy your house, because you're going to end up there anyway.
That's right. Either or Southern California or Nevada or Arizona.
Right. Yeah, I mean, choose the four places. Right, just go. What, you know, why, oh, I hate the snow. I hate the weather. Da, 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 da,
get out of here.
Get out of here. Yeah, right. And so that's another thing. It's not obvious or common sense. Dave Ramsey's, I'm not dismissing any. Those are all good things.
Sure.
But I think there's other things, especially if you're younger, like if you have kids and buy a house, you're kind of committed now.
Yeah, you
are. So do the setup work now before you're 25.
Okay.
Figure out where you want to live. You don't have to live there that day. Okay. But like I bought land in South Dakota knowing I wanted to live there someday.
And now building, you will.
Now I'm building on it. So that's another thing I would do. And then...
build wealth and give. That's kind of nebulous.
I wouldn't give. I don't give.
Okay.
Not to be political, but we spend about 40% of GDP on government, 2/3 of which goes to...
Okay, well, then there you go.
And it's not working. And so, like, so I would, you know, give to charities that you care about. Like, if I were to give to charity, and I might, you know, when I pass away, there's a outfit that does research to exonerate people wrongly convicted.
Oh, okay.
I'm like, dude, being stuck in prison when you're innocent, I'm like, dude. Okay, I'll give to that. But
let me ask you this. You know, which is worse? Is it convicting the innocent or freeing the guilty?
I think convicting the innocent.
I agree.
It's a flip of a coin, but
I guess it's a flip of a coin. Because if you, and now I'm not talking about freeing the obviously guilty, right? Ted Bundy, you can't free that guy. Jeffrey Dahmer, you know, you can't free those guys. Right. So those guys are serial killers. But if there is, and I think I know we're getting off track here, but just allow me to expound on this. The burden of proof in criminal court is guilt beyond all reasonable doubt. Mm-hmm. And that is supposed to ensure that we don't convict the innocent.
Correct.
But guilt beyond all reasonable doubt, that has obviously been lowered because people have been convicted when there is not a lot of evidence to suggest that they are guilty. And it's all over the map. Casey Anthony, how the hell did she get off, right?
I didn't know she got off.
Dude.
I thought, yeah.
So Casey Anthony got off. Anthony absolutely got off. There was no way she should have got off. Then Devin and I were watching this one show, and I think it was on A&E. They had this girl. She was 15 years old, and she was accused of killing this dude. There was so much this was in Tennessee. There was so much circumstantial evidence. It was ridiculous. And I remember thinking, well, yeah, she's going to be not guilty. In the end, they convicted her and gave her 60 years in prison. I said, that was a gross miscarriage of justice. Like, you have to be kidding me. So I think freeing the obviously guilty, I'm thinking serial killers, all those guys.
Sure.
But I think it's far worse to convict the innocent than it is to free the guilty. That's what I say.
I hate not being free.
Oh,
I mean, and I don't mean to be like I was in a prison, but
no, but
if
I understand.
You go to college, you're going to a K through college is a quasi prison. I know you had fun times, but I look at it, I'm like, golly, you know, I just want to go sledding and do anything else.
Right.
And then you could consider work a quasi prison, but everyone has to work to support themselves.
Of course.
But then what the heck are you here for if you're not going to go be free? So I cannot imagine being imprisoned, wrongfully so, and then stuck in a cell.
Oh my God.
That is just, and that's why, if I was ever given life or a life sentence, I'd say, can I get the electric chair? Because there's no way I'm going to suffer that.
Yeah.
So yeah, I am all very pro freedom. And certainly, I feel horrible for people who are stuck in that essential torture. And so I would definitely be, it's worse to wrongly convict the innocent.
There are some things that are worse than death, and life in prison is one of them. What's up?
I just wanted to say that most of the innocent people that are in jail never had a trial. They were all had to take plea bargains or things like that.
Settlements.
Yeah, so what she's saying is she doesn't have a mic. Most of the people that were wrongly convicted didn't even have a trial.
Okay.
You know, and that's, oh my God. I don't want to get off on that tangent. I just thought that's just sort of a question that I normally pose to people. Let me check here. For whatever reason, the internet here is, the Wi-Fi here is just, it's kind of slowing up here. Here's another question from one of my patrons. What is your definition of minimalism?
Well,
that's a very good question.
It's placing time above money. Like, you can get to the point that you place time above money.
Okay.
Because there's different, like, there are some hardcore minimalists where it's their religion.
Yes.
And I know these guys, and I wouldn't say it's a cult, but they all live together.
Oh,
it's a bunch of guys. They all have bikes.
Wow.
They all take public transportation, and they each share a room. And there's also personality that goes with it. They're all very clean and mm-hmm. very quiet, and that's fine. And I think they just like reading their books. They have no desire to travel or see the world.
Right.
Whereas
survive on $15 a month.
Right. Oh, they can get by on
it's very little.
Whereas I'm going to die. Don't know about you guys, but I'm going to die.
Yeah, I think I probably will too.
I kind of want to sample little things life, and it's going to cost a little bit of money. Now, for example, I rented a Ferrari.
Yes.
Because I don't want to buy a Ferrari, but I got to see what driving a Ferrari is like. I had a very nice hotel room on my 40th birthday in Vegas, so I got to see what a suite was like. Okay.
Suite pad?
Right. more recently, I'm going to buy, I don't know if you collected coins, I'm going to buy a 1909 SVDB wheat penny and a 1955 double die.
How much is that going to run you?
It depends on the condition, but the 55 double die and the three-legged buffalo nickel, roughly $1,000 a piece.
Wow. And so you're a serious coin collector.
Well, no, I'm not, because when I was a kid, I was a serious coin collector, but I had $10, saved up over a month of collecting cans in Michigan, which was a lot of money in 1983.
Yes, it was, man. Hell, it's a lot of money in Michigan now.
Yeah. So I'm okay. Do I need it? No. But why the heck am I here? And I see people pursuing minimalism to the detriment of them enjoying life.
So I
want to own, and those will go up in value, or at least keep up with inflation. They're collectibles. I'll pass them on to my nieces or sell them if I need to. But I'd like to have some occasional nice things.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to compete with the Joneses. I'm not going to get a home equity line to afford the new Cadillac Escalade that starts at Lord knows what this year. I'm not going to get fancy clothes. I'll get hand-me-downs clothes are practically free anyway now.
Yeah, right.
And I do want to have some good food every once in a while. So defining minimalism, it's really hard, but I would, if you needed an objective definition, it's when you realize that your time is more important than your money and that you don't need things. I guess even a better way is this is not my quote, this is somebody else. The richest man in the world is someone who can walk into the Mall of America and leave with nothing. I'm sorry. The richest man in the world who can afford everything in the Mall of America and walk out with nothing. That is what I think would be the hurdle.
My time is extremely valuable to me. But at this point, money is a little bit more important. And I think the reason for that is because I'm spending a lot of time to make money. I can't do this. Dude, if I do this at this rate for another 5 years, I'm going to look like I'm 75 when I'm barely 50. So the reason I'm putting my foot on the gas, I'm just going full bore, man. Every once in a while, I'll take some time off and relax and go do something fun. But my goal is, I'm 43 now. By the time I'm 48, before 50 years old, I want to be able to, just like you said, have freedom. And I'm never going to stop doing this, but I'd like to do this 20 hours a week, something like that. The rest of the time, maybe. I love riding bikes, man. I love being outdoors, camping. I lived in Nevada for almost a decade, and there's, oh my God, just the outdoor it's life wonderful. There is just something I would love to do. That's a good, I like that you said you don't want to be minimalist at the detriment of enjoying life, right? We are all going to die someday. Let's have a little bit of fun, but let's not have so much fun to the detriment of our finances, I suppose.
And also related to like how you're working so much now, and me and Rolla were talking about this. What's going to happen again, and a lot of people, look, it's not this it's not the 50s anymore.
No, it's not.
A manufacturing industry where it's all robots and it's banged out in 8-hour shifts.
That's
And everything is, it's not that reliable anymore. You don't get your 35 years in at the place.
No.
So what you're doing is you're striking while the iron's hot, because I guarantee you the day is coming this will go away. Maybe not your show, maybe not, the internet or anything like that, but the money we make, I remember I'd be doing great and a recession would hit.
Yeah,
right. I made 46 grand teaching dance classes 1 year.
Wow.
The next year it was the .com bubble, and then that dropped down to 17. So don't necessarily think think, well, you don't need all this money. A lot of people also ask me, well, if you advocate minimalism, why do you advocate majoring in engineering? So you can work 2 hours a day.
There you go.
And so if you're making good money and you're on fire, bang away.
That's right.
Squirrel it away, because the day is coming, 7 years feast, 7 years famine. Something's going to happen. It could be the economy, or we had the COVID thing.
Yeah.
You know, just bank that money. And then, oh, the recession, I guess I'll hop on my motorcycle.
There you go.
Go, go bum around.
Yeah. That is freedom. I like that. Here's another question from one of my patrons. This is interesting. He says, what advice do you have for someone who is constantly restless? He says, I can't seem to stay in one city, one job for more than 1 to 2 years. I'm always looking for something new and thinking along the lines of the grass is greener on the other side. That's an interesting question.
The grass is not greener.
Okay.
That's, but at the same time, there's nothing wrong with being restless.
Right.
I think he's just, that's his personality. And I've faced this problem. You know the solution to restlessness? Accept it.
Okay.
That's who you are. You know, like kids who have ADHD, it's like, oh, there's something wrong. No, maybe you're just sticking them in a really boring place called where you're having fun, though, apparently.
Of course, yes, right. Yes.
But you're the type A. Go, and if you are type A, I cannot recommend hiking and mountain climbing enough. I cannot recommend motorcycling enough, kayaking, things that just take long distance, you know, running and things like that. If you're bored and you want to try it, go ahead and try it. Because here's what will happen. I think, you know, you and I are roughly the same age. You will get tired.
Yes, you will.
Like, you and I now have earlier bedtimes than we did.
That's right. That's right.
Whoa, 7:30.
Oh, hey, boy, hey. I got to start winding down here.
So, I mean, and I bet you there'd be some old men who would kill to have this guy's energy and restlessness. And so, go do it, man. Go have your fun and enjoy life. And don't fight it. But don't worry, the day will come. I wonder if Knight Rider's on reruns today.
Oh, dude, you know? I'd be in on that, man. Yeah. Dude, Kit versus Car. That was the
best
episode.
Was a good,
yeah. Yeah, it was a great episode. Let's see here. Oh, here's another question. As someone who will graduate college soon with no debt and some extra money saved up, should I go straight into a job or do some reconnaissance first?
Ooh, good
Fantastic question.
I do reconnaissance first. If he's got the money, yeah, because absolutely. Because then that'll help him determine where he wants to start throwing job applications.
Yeah, plant a flag,
Okay. Yeah, he's been going to school since 5 years old.
Oh, God,
it's like, take some time off, because you can go plug yourself back into the matrix, and it's work is like school, but with less hot chicks, and you get paid. That's basically work. That's all it is.
Here's another question. What are your thoughts on using life insurance to fund things like buying a house or using it to start a business?
You can borrow against it. I'm against life insurance. And now, if he has kids, fine.
Okay.
But I've never understood why people get life insurance who don't have kids, because you can't collect it, because to get it,
you gotta die. Right. Yeah,
there's an event there that happens. So or
stipulation
maybe,
there.
Right. If your wife, like another reason, if maybe your wife agrees to be a traditional stay-at-home wife and raise the kids. All right. Well, she's sacrificed her career or at least some work, so you might want to get some health insurance or life insurance there too. But yeah, if you have a life insurance policy, you can borrow against its cash value.
Okay.
You know, there's other tricks and things you can do, but you got to pay yourself back, and then.
Is it just? It just seems really sticky. A lot of moving parts to that.
Yeah, you're complicating it. But it's there's nothing wrong with it. I'm more worried about what do you invest in.
Yeah,
I want to start
what kind of business.
Well, and you know the best kind of business to start?
What's that?
One that doesn't need money to start.
What? Okay. Well, what businesses don't need money to start?
Like, for example, asshole consulting.
Oh,
you know,
okay.
An idea, all right? And technically, in the grand scheme, now I know you got a lot of, but
it yeah, really but it didn't cost me anything to be on YouTube.
No, I mean, it's like, okay, you need a $200 webcam and a $50 microphone.
Not even.
Yeah. And so that, I'm not saying everyone go become a YouTube personality.
Oh, no, listen, trust me, everybody's trying it, dude. Yeah. Everybody's trying it.
I know, but there are business ideas out there that don't take a lot of money.
Huh,
and I've seen this working in banking, where I've seen small businesses fail. You know why? Because everyone's doing the same small business. I want to run a bar. Well, so do you and every other washed-up middle-aged guy who wants to relive the olden days. I want to do a trinkets and bobble shop. Well, so does every other trophy wife in the
Right.
So, like, no, we're not lending you money to buy crap. I would first really evaluate whether his business is a good business idea.
Okay.
has he run figures? Another great thing is to
projections.
Go right, but a really great resource is Risk Management Associates, RMA data. Go to your library because it's very expensive. Otherwise, a large library should have it for free and look up what business you want to start. It's just basically a compendium of industry average income statements by percentages.
Okay.
So it shows you what percent you can expect to make. And so every, I'm trying to think, you know, every girl, every guy too, I want to run a restaurant. Do you know how painfully stupid that is?
Dude, it is just, and it's every, like I like the archetype of the guy who wants to run a bar, the woman who wants to run a trinket shop. It seems that couples want to run, let's open a restaurant. And they have this rosy idea of the two of them just sort of being the center of attention and everybody's happy, but it's never like
it's
that,
not.
Man.
Even, did you listen to Joker's episode on when he worked at the strip club?
Yeah, oh yeah. And yeah. That's like, why I had him on.
Well, it's... You're like, oh, naked chicks? That's what you see behind it. There's accounting. There's people stealing. There's
prostitution,
drama,
maybe.
Cops. Yeah. I mean, right. Bouncing. So I would look very closely at what he's doing. And usually you're just better off throwing that money in the market somehow.
Yeah. Yeah. I would wholeheartedly agree on that. Oh, here we go. How do you deal with the stigma and social isolation of being different?
It sucks. You just suffer.
Okay.
There's
really no way to deal with it.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people, I wish there was like Thanos snap, oh, here's your problem. And there's a lot of people that are also facing this now, especially with
COVID. Yeah, with the COVID,
But then also we are getting more and more secluded and atomized through social media. Like people don't go on dates anymore. And as you get older, I don't know if this is the case, but man, I got to get a pliers and pull somebody's teeth to get them to go have a beer or go do something fun.
Oh, dude, yeah.
And
it's tough.
Yeah.
It really is tough.
And it's...
Listen, same with Dev, man. Yeah. Like, she has friends around the area, and it takes an act of God, hey, let's meet up for lunch, or, you know, it's incredible.
Yeah,
man. It really
so
is.
It is shocking how few people want to live life.
Yeah.
I mean, they just, man, go and watch their TV or... have their drinks or whatever it is. You just suffer. And what I do is I try to stay very busy, either through work, writing books, whatever else, podcasting. I mean, that's I guarantee you half the reason I podcast has nothing to do with money. It's like I got to go talk to somebody. Even
yeah,
if it's
right.
On the effing internet.
Right. Right.
Hey, Jack, you're over in Holland. What's going on? Oh, the docks flooded. Cool. Germany invading this time? No. All right. But I think one of the things, not just this problem, but any problem, is to acknowledge sometimes there's not a solution.
Yeah.
People are in debt. What do I do? Well, one, stop worrying about what you're going to do. You're going to work hard. You're going to save your money. It's going to suck for the next 5 years. You know,
there's always a price.
There's always a price. And trying to find the easy way around, you know, I want to get a girl. Every guy wants to get the girl. Well, you know how you get the girls? The number one thing, go lose weight.
There you go.
You know, that's
it.
You know, hit the gym and be prepared to embrace the suck for the rest of your life of hitting the gym. Although some people like hitting the gym. And change your diet.
It's not going to be easy, but if that's what you want.
Yeah.
And with so many people... And it like I see it in different chats and different podcasts. They almost treat it as a Google search, how to get better with women. And I'm like, dude, that's in the chat. Like, I'm not a Google search bar, right? How to deal with no, Donovan, how do I deal? But you understand
pronouns.
The language.
Yeah,
yes,
yeah.
Pronouns, please. Pronouns, proper nouns. Let's use those. It's killing me. The first super chat that I see here is from Ed Lattimore, Dev. So. My iPad crapped out on me for a little bit. So if there's anything before Ed Lattimore's $15 super chat and Red Pill Mike's $100 super chat, let me know.
That legit Ed Lattimore?
Yeah, that's Ed Lattimore.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah, Ed Lattimore. I'm going to have him. I'm actually going to have him out here for season two,
be
man.
Be nice to him.
He's a, yes. Listen, man, I've been in a lot of, there aren't too many people on this planet that I am physically afraid of. Ed is one of them. Like, when you see, and the guy's a heavyweight boxer, dude. Like, and I've taken punches to the face before. Dude, I can't imagine getting hit by that guy.
Yes, sir. How high, dude. Sir? Absolutely, sir.
His fists are like the size of my face, dude. I'm
you
like.
Know, I bet you he's kind of like Jack Donovan. the nicest guy ever.
Oh, dude, you know? Ed is totally cool. Ed is totally cool, man. Yeah, and the thing I like about Ed, he's got a degree in? I think it's either engineering.
IT. I think it's physics.
Oh, that's what
physics.
It is.
Yeah, it's physics.
The guy's a freaking genius. The guy is, I mean, he's both sides of the, Ed Lattimore is walking hypergamy.
You know why he's better than us? Because he went in the military.
There you go, man. Like, dude, that's what it is. I'm telling you, the military.
Dude, and the girls, you put on that uniform. Even dumbass security uniform. Yep. It was still.
It's all, dude. I'm telling you, right. I remember my ex-wife's father used to say this. He used to say, it should be mandatory for all 18-year-olds when they graduate from high school, you got to serve 2 years in the military. He said it would change the country. It would teach them responsibility, discipline, et cetera. And I kind of agreed with him there. Okay, so Ed Lattimore, $15, says, F them, go ahead, switch up your style. And if they hate, let them hate. And let your money pile up. Hashtag hood gospel. Real talk. C-Dub. $20 says, I took AP classes in high school and earned an entire semester of college credit in advance. Most states offer 2 years of free community college to knock out basics. No reason to pay for over 2 years of a bachelor's degree.
Absolutely.
Yep. I got a personal question to ask you. Devin's sister has a 12-year-old. She had a 12-year-old daughter. She's going to be 13, I think, in March or April. I can't remember exactly. Cute as a button. Beautiful girl. Eyes shining with intelligence. When she wants to get good at something, I remember, and this is actually when I first moved here, she will get good at things. She wanted to do contortion.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. And so she did. Like, we went to her talent show just to watch her. It was incredible. She wanted to learn magic. She's doing magic tricks. Really? Every time she come over here, Donovan, want to see a magic trick? And I'm genuinely like, wow, how did you do that? What else did she learned how to do these hexaflexagons. She learned how to do slime. Now
slime.
Yeah, she learned how to
make slime.
Yeah, she made like 100 variations of slime. Her mom took her out there at a fall festival. She made like $78 selling the
slime. Selling slime?
It was unbelievable. Whatever this girl puts her mind to, she gets good at. Now she's doing digital video rendering off of this app or something called Blender. And whenever she comes to the house, she's talking my ear off about it for like 10 minutes, and I don't understand anything she's saying, but she is the, I guess she is the, to me, she's the quintessential example of someone who could really make something of herself, but I can't imagine her on a college campus, and it's not for the educational reasons,
no,
right?
No, she's going to have to go to some elite school. No doubt IT or engineering, kind of STEM, because she's just so creative.
Yeah, that's
her
what it is.
Her mind will get bogged down and tortured trying to read the pablum that would be the sociologies or social sciences or the liberal arts. She needs something concrete because she might even be a good tradesman. You know,
right?
It's like, I got to fit it. I got to make.
I think that's how she is. She's always, she likes to work with her hands, man.
No, that gal, one, she needs to be tested for an IQ. Okay. Two, her parents have got to okay, what do we do? You know, and talk to her because she's 12. Now's a good time to start having conversations.
Right,
sweetheart,
right.
What do you think? And three, you know, kind of like, well, here's your options. But you know, boy, a brain like that and the creativity, I never made slime, let alone 78 variations of it.
Oh my God.
Let alone selling it.
Dude, it's crazy.
So
crazy.
I would almost kind of like, well, here's all the tools you want, and you're probably going to be more successful than us. So,
well,
however we can help you. But
I talk to Dev's sister all the time, man. I'm like you do understand what happens on college campuses, right? Right? You do know that your little girl is a good, she's going to be a good-looking female when she grows up.
Yeah. I'd skip college. Well, that's going to happen, and we're not going to be there 24/7.
Yeah, but, dude, I mean, it's going to, listen, man, girls, here's my assertion. Any 25-year-old's notch count, if she went to a 4-year school, I can promise you 75% of the sausage she took was in college.
Right.
College ruins girls. And I'm trying to make Kathy, listen, man, keep your geek, Olivia.
Get in there. Cause I got nieces.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
Now they're 4 and 7.
Oh,
and
so they're
great. You know, right. They're not, we don't have to worry
ankle
about
biters,
boys.
Yeah.
Yeah. They candy and ice cream
right.
And adventure and ride in the truck illegally.
Oh,
and
of course,
on
of
motorcycle.
Course.
Oh God. It's just very easy. But they just need guys, and, you know, and you're probably one of the better influences that's available to her to tell her, really, listen, guys are scum. How do I know? I was one.
Yes.
You know, I mean, oh, yeah. Like, look out for that, 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 that. And that's, you know, that's the best you can really do.
It's funny. I took a sheet and she knows who I am and what I do. Like, she's aware. And I remember, where were we? I think I told her if she makes like a certain GPA, I was going to take her to the mall and pick her out a pair of shoes or whatever. So I took her to the mall and we're just walking around the mall. We're eating ice cream or whatever. She's like, hey, Donovan. I was like, what? She's like, what do you think of that? And it's a portly woman in a bikini. Oh. I was like, oh, and you're starting to understand, huh?
Good.
And she knows I'm kind of a hothead. So she'll kind of, ooh, what do you think of that? And I'll, you know, get off on my tirades or whatever. But I just, I guess the point is.
You have
a
big button on your back she just presses?
Dude, okay. It's got to be there because everybody, people know right how to. There. I'm getting a back tattoo, so people can't see the button anymore. But I just don't want her to be ruined by college. I can't. And she's the type of little girl, man, who could easily, like, you could still see the twinkle in her eyes. Hope. But then you see what happens to girls when they get out of college. They've got that thousand, you know what, stare and. That doesn't breed creativity after that, right?
Oh, she might. Her priorities will shift. I remember having I had a little girl in my life, and this was like my gladiator.
Yeah, right.
Because it was basically me, except girl form and, you know, little.
Yeah, right.
Well, then boys. And that, and then, oh, that's no, that's, and I was like, it was sad and depressed because this is a brilliant kid. So get in there now. You know, get in there, and I've seen it where the dads get in, or the older brothers get in, or uncle gets in, or whatever. Listen, and then they go the right way. But, you know, having her go to school online and not actually going to a campus and having a frank conversation, she's smart enough to say, listen, kid, let's go over some numbers here.
Right.
And you got to think, and look, if she knows to point out the fat girl in the bikini,
right,
she's smart enough to know, you know, what $120,000 is. She probably even knows what compound.
Here's another advantage. Mom and dad are both very smart, highly intelligent. Actually, if I'm not mistaken, her father dropped out of high school, got a GED, was making, you know, six figures doing graphic design.
Right.
So that just goes to show that you don't, I mean, don't get me wrong. Now, I told her, I was like, I think I joke with her, if you drop out of high school, whatever, I'm never getting you ice cream again or whatever the case may be. But yeah, she thinks it's funny.
Yeah, that scoop of ice cream is going to keep her in school. Yeah.
Right. Well, I don't know. Listen, she's still 12, so that might work. But just like you say, her priorities change. So we'll have a conversation about that sometime. But I don't know. Like, the more she comes over, the more attached I appear to be getting. And, you know, you want the best for children who seem to be. And she's a good kid.
Yeah.
Okay, so she talks back. She's a little bit mouthy, but she's not rebellious. She does what she's told to do. And I'm just like, I just don't want this little girl to be ruined. Anyway, Chris Von Erich, $15, says Donovan is 100% genuine and goes out of his way to help fellow creators. And Aaron is the de facto guy to seek out if you need financial assistance.
Yes.
By the way, my accountant is a guy that you recommended.
Right.
Yeah, did you tell him I was sorry about the Dallas Stars in the Stanley Cup?
Yeah, we were hanging out and I said, oh, what a day. And he's like, oh yeah, I guess he's all right with it. He wasn't crying.
Yeah, it's been a little while. So, Zen Long, $10 says, Aaron, what is your opinion on carless living? Arizona is even planning to make a carless living apartment complex in Tempe. Do you see this trend becoming mainstream or beneficial if it does?
I see kind of a share economy. And there already exists like Turo or
e-car.
So I'm not against it. There's a market for it. And it really is dependent upon the city. Like Chicago is a great town to have public transportation.
Sure. New York. Right.
But then LA, you're hosed. Vegas, you're hosed without having a car. But yeah, if you got, especially now that people are working online, you don't necessarily have to worry about a commute or having to have a car for that.
Right.
So if it's social, and if you're the type to walk, and it's and the other thing's environment, Minnesota, you need a car.
Yes, Philadelphia, yes, you do.
Yeah, here you need a car.
Yes, you definitely need a car, yeah.
So, and then, you know, also how much do you want to travel? Do you need to go overseas? Do you want to visit your folks? That kind of thing. But yeah, I'd be very curious to see how that works. But I have a feeling it will be a temporary situation, because your environment, your work, your career, change where, that's the college campus is Tempe, if I remember correctly.
Yeah.
It makes sense there. You're young.
Okay.
Scottsdale's a little note. That but makes sense. If you could get by without a car, you'll save a lot of money.
Of course. Yeah, of course. Jim Ed, $2 says, where is the Minister Jap photo on the wall? Dude, I thought I had ordered a Minister Because I don't see it on the wall. Deb, did it not come in? It must. Maybe I didn't get it. I didn't order one? I could have, because that was one of the better photos. Yeah, listen, Jim Ed, I'm going to take a screen grab of this because that was one of the better photos that we took. I'm definitely going to have to order that Minister Jap photo. I got to get him on that wall. Thanks for the reminder, man, because it never occurred to me that he was not up here. That was a very good episode. Ken Rose, $5, says, so you can actually get your GED if you're younger than 18 and skip high school? Well, I never knew that. I thought you had to be 18 and over.
You don't have to. It depends on the state.
Okay.
Right? It does vary by state. But forget the GED.
Okay.
For a second. Okay. Just go to college online.
Okay.
Like, let's say you're going to be taking Economics 101 in high school, which would be microeconomics. Take an Economics 101 course in college because the study is going to be the same thing.
Okay.
You're going to take calculus in high school. Take calculus in college. Do you need to drop out of high school? Or, like, let's say you go to high school. Okay. You're in a study hall. Or you're in history class,
yeah,
and it's study time. Well, break out your history book for college and study there. It really is just saving time. And is it going to be perfect? Like, are you going to have to pay attention to whatever, your English teacher in high school? You'll have to acknowledge her existence. Like, yeah, okay, I see you.
Yes, Miss Crabtree.
Oh, yeah. Right. Oh, I before E, except after C. Thank God. Oh,
wow, I remember that, yeah.
Because I wasn't verbal, literate, or well-written at the age of 17. That's why I still got to take this class to employ you. So, but yeah, there's ways to do it. But if, you know, look at your local state law.
Okay.
What it is. Now, as you said, some states also allow you to take college while you're for free.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Michigan, as long as you're in high school, I don't know if it's this way anymore, you could go to college for free at the state system. So I knew two kids who kept flunking out of high school. They were like 20 and still in high school, so they could go to college for free.
Wow.
I'm like, they're brilliant. Brilliant.
Wow. Yeah. That's a good plan.
That's a very clever plan.
Wow. So they're flunking out of high school, but still get
straight
still
A's. Going to college. They both had straight A's in college. Like, yeah.
So I have a degree, but I don't have a high school diploma. Okay, we're good. Got it.
When's the last time you asked for your high school diploma?
Never. Right. Never. Right. Dude, never, ever. Dude, I remember when dropping out of high school was the scarlet letter.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But now you don't, dude, education has evolved. Education has not evolved. People are waking up. Education is sort of subjective. Because I could have done this whether I graduated from high school or college or not. Everything I learned about what I do and talk about here, I didn't learn any of this stuff in the classroom. Right. The cameras and the game and the girls, all of that stuff was taught by, I mean, just by going out there and doing it, man.
I don't know if you know Dr. David Perodin. He's a
no, I've never heard
PhD
of him.
In safety. He's on PBS and all these other things.
Okay.
Him and I are buddies. And he was telling me that he went through all of his education and he only used, this is a doctorate.
Sure.
He only used three classes of anything. I mean, that's how much overkill and how impractical the education is.
God almighty, man. Dan C with the $2 super. Oh, okay. Never mind. This is in the Sharp stream. Said, I would make my child do one contract with the U.S. military for the post 9/11 GI Bill for free schooling.
Mm-hmm.
Not a bad idea. Red Sings the Blues, $5, says, love this Joe Rogan-esque show. Man, a different side to the Sharp. Of course, this is a different, softer side of Donovan Sharp. In other words, I'm not sucking all the air out of the room. Gordon W, $5, says, I'm 30, single with no kids, and will have a degree in CS in 6 months with no debt. What should I focus on first financially, saving or investing?
I'd say, well, get his, like we talked before about the triage, you know, Dave Ramsey. Yeah, I would get your 3 to 6 month FU fund, micro FU fund.
Okay, okay.
I would travel, though, like the other guy, too. If he can go travel before you start your, maybe he already has a job, but if you can go, you know, hit Dallas, hit Vegas, hit Phoenix, hit places that are warm and have no state income tax, Tennessee, Florida, that kind of thing.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, but I would build up the micro FU fund.
Okay.
Savings, and then I would get into investing.
Okay, very good. Good answer. I like that. Gordon W, $2, says, I had a super chat ahead of Red Pill Mike, and I think I just read that. Carlin Mitchell, $5, said, spent the last year learning Blender. Now with my denture business started, making a pretty penny 3D printing dental surgical guides. Clever girl. Devin, are you hearing this? Are you serious?
This isn't the kid, is it?
No. This dude says that he started learning Blender last year. Now with his denture business started making a pretty penny, 3D printing digital dental surgical guides. We need to get, you know what we're going to do? We're going to get Olivia. We're going to get her. We need to get her a 3D printer for Christmas.
Oh, boy.
God, can you imagine what? What'd oh, you know create? What? I might put her ass to work, dude. Like, for serious.
Statues like, of Donovan?
You know, no, oh.
Yeah, right.
Don't say anything. I had, dude, it's just, dude, I just don't know how. And she's a little girl. She like this. She likes candy and
they're
lollipops
tricky,
and getting
man.
Her nails
they're
done and all that.
They're smart. They play dumb. They're not dumb. They know what they're doing.
I just cannot believe how smart this little girl is. It's crazy. But she's still a little girl. And Deb and I joke all the time. We're like, dude, if Kathy brings over Olivia and she doesn't get excited when we tell her we're taking a Chuck E. Cheese because it's really more for us than her, then we know she's starting to grow up. But we can still say, hey, want to go to Chuck E. Cheese? She's like, yeah, okay, all right. Cool. She's still there. Man, that's incredible, man. Yeah, I think we need to get her a 3D printer, Dev. I really do. I think she would enjoy that. Man, this is crazy.
The new Elon Musk in the making.
Dude, oh, my God. Ay, ay, ay. Ugh, I can't wrap my mind around that. Clem joke. Interesting. $5 says, the only time I was asked for my high school diploma was when I enlisted in the National Guard. Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. Right, exactly. That's incredible, man. I've never really thought of it that way. Couple of the... Oh, Dev, by the way, grab a Red Bull, hand it to Aaron so that he can hand it to me, because...
I see. Okay.
I need... What I'm going to do is I'm going to... I should just get the IV and just, you know, do it intravenously. Patreon question says, what is the... This is a good question. What is the best way to place your assets so that if you decide to get serious with a woman, you can minimize the loss should things go good or bad?
That is trust. You need to hire a trust attorney.
There it is.
There you go. You do the sugar?
Or sugar? I'm doing sugar. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow. Oh, yeah. You're serious.
Yes. Well, that's why I have tatas right now, my friend. So a trust.
A trust. Yeah,
irrevocable trust?
That I don't know. Okay. I got trust lawyers. You want to hire a lawyer who specializes in trusts. You can do things a little bit more simply because trust lawyers are expensive. They're going to cost a penny. You need something to put in the trust.
Yep.
But I would say you go buy some silver, precious metals, Bitcoin, cryptocurrency. Of course, those cryptocurrency especially is very volatile, so there's a risk involved in that. But silver and precious metals, and you just hide it, you know, and or you like leave it with a buddy or something like that. That's what I would do. Now, keep in mind, though, if you're trying to hide your lion's share of wealth, I mean, that's going to be a lot of silver, a lot of gold, and you're going to be subjected to...
What about liquidating a lot of it? Keeping it in a safe somewhere, safety deposit box.
Well, and now there's a record. I'm not joking.
Yeah, that makes sense, man.
You go with cash. You pay someone cash to go to Walmart to buy a bin so the cameras pick up somebody else.
Oh.
And then you get this bin and a lot of saran wrap. And then you bury your stuff somewhere, probably several different bins, so that if your stash is found or somebody's following you, but you literally cachet it and hide it.
Okay.
That'd be about the only way I could think of. But in a more legal sense, if you want it digital or accessible in a bank account.
What about storage unit?
Are you not signing the lease in your name? There's a paper or digital trail.
This is why
Donovan.
This guy. Wow, man. See that? Man, oh, man.
So I would contact a trust lawyer, also like getting a CPA like Chad Alkins. Yeah. He's my CPA. He doesn't necessarily specialize in trust, but he does know accountants and lawyers that do.
So if he puts his money in a trust, it can't be touched.
A trust is a separate legal entity. Consider it another human.
Wow.
And it has a beneficiary that you designate, typically your children.
Okay.
But it could be a nonprofit. No, because then it's like, You're the beneficiary of the trust.
Oh,
cash
wow.
in your trust.
Jesus Christ. Wow.
So a trust is basically you manage it, you're in control of it, but it is a designated beneficiary. The money goes to somebody else.
And that's not a paper held trail
in,
to you.
Yeah, held in trust for that person.
Man, that's incredible. That's fascinating. Yeah. Okay, very good. Hi, Aaron. When my father dies, I'm due to inherit a tidy sum, more than $2 million, as I'm an only child. This will probably happen within 15 years. Despite this, I do try to be very fiscally responsible and frugal, and even without this inheritance, I built up a good position. Some friends of mine have told me that I should be a little looser with my money and enjoy it since I have this buffer to rely on. And in a way, what they say makes sense because nobody wants to be that person who just dies with a lot of money. But I still can't bring myself to do it. Should I keep being frugal or let loose a bit, as they say?
Do you know what the point of wealth is?
No.
All right.
Just being rich, I suppose.
The point of wealth is security, safety, and serenity and peace.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Because you'll get your Ferrari, you'll get your boat, and you know what? Right. Novelty has a shelf life mm-hmm. on everything. I don't care if Sophia Loren from 1958 comes up to me and Ooh. Says, I will be tired of her in a year.
That's right.
All right? That's right. So your whatever physical items wealth could buy you will tire of
okay.
it, no matter what. So then what is the point and purpose of wealth? Well, what wealth does really is buys you peace of mind, calm and security, all right? Unfortunately, I think it's too late. He told his friends he's got this money coming, right?
Oh, Jesus
right?
Christ.
That's
yeah,
the
now,
number
yeah.
one thing. If you have $2 million, you don't... Did you hear about the guy in Jamaica who won the lottery?
No.
What he did is he put on the Scream mask to collect it in person. So his family members wouldn't know.
Oh, that's brilliant.
If you have...
He won the lottery and put on the
yeah,
mask.
Put on
oh
the mask
wow!
That because is, he knew all of his family and friends would be asking him for money. And if wow. you have money, you do not tell anyone about it.
Ay, ay,
okay,
ay.
You certainly don't flash it around.
No.
Okay.
No.
So what? So that mistake. Caveat being said,
that's great.
He can. I don't know what the money is going to buy him. All right, his friends want him to loosen up a little bit, but is he happy? Does he have good friends in his life? Is he in love? Does he have kids? That's the most important thing. Could he go on a world trip? Sure. And I would recommend he do. Could he get steak instead of the chicken? All right, yeah, you know, live a little bit. But to be perfectly honest, what I would do with the money, make sure you have no debts here.
Okay.
Make sure your house is paid off.
There you go.
No debt. Have yourself an adequate amount of money, at least $300,000
okay.
For 401k IRA retirement funds. And then personally, I would start looking to buying property or having an investment account overseas.
Hmm.
Because there's also a political risk. Every country could collapse.
Okay.
All right. And I used to be a sovereign risk analyst, and I would look, for example, Indonesia.
Wow.
Was
man,
one
so really
where in the 90s it was all chaotic and it was like booming, everything's great. Then it was incredibly corrupt. But, like, for example, Vietnam started putting down capital controls. You can't withdraw your money out of Vietnam. India did the same thing with gold. You can't have gold come out of India. You don't own your property. That's what they're doing. If they didn't have an intention of taking it at some time, they'd let you take your money and leave.
Right.
So to avoid political risk, which the United States is perfectly susceptible to.
Of course. Of
perfectly
course.
Susceptible to. That's my next goal, if I ever make the money, is mm-hmm. I'm going to be having someplace overseas. Maybe not actual house. Maybe I just get land. Maybe it'd be an investment account. That's the next major project I'm going to be working on in 2021. But that is what I'd recommend he look into.
Wow.
And having like a life raft in case his home country goes to pot.
Okay. Yep. All right. Very good. And like, don't tell your friends. Maybe tell them, hey, they didn't pay it out. Like my dad.
Yeah. Oh, dead. Dang. Yeah. My dad. Oh, health bills.
Yeah. And then get on a G5 and get out of there. Right?
A G5 airplane and lots of money.
Jesus Christ. Here's another question here. So good idea or bad idea to give kids in their 20s their inheritance early via annual gifts, both STEM, good jobs, no debt. I paid for college, already saving, not extravagant, but not minimalist. Worried they'll get too used to the extra money.
Did he pay? He said he paid for their college?
He put them, they're both in STEM careers. They have great jobs. They don't have any debt. He put them through college. They're already saving. They're not extravagant, but they're not minimalist.
Nope. They need to suffer more.
Okay. Okay.
He didn't spoil them.
Good.
He was a good father.
Yes.
He got them into STEM, but he did help them lift the weights a little bit and pay for their college.
Okay.
I think everyone needs to suffer so that they know what waits them if they screw up.
Yeah.
They need to be hungry, they need to be poor, and they need to be cold, and they need to face homelessness
That's
at
right.
least once. And
yes.
And that will scare you straight and give you the strongest work ethic ever. So I would let him, he invested very well.
He did.
I don't think they appreciate what he did for them. Heck, because they can't. They don't know what a good path he put them on.
Yeah.
I'm sure they're thankful, but
they don't think they can quite. Yeah. They have
no idea.
No, I agree. No, I totally agree. Nonstop Dre 360 says pain is the greatest teacher. You better believe it. Pain is the greatest teacher. I had a few more questions here from my audience. Ah, here we go. What is the best way to go about higher education, specifically the debt that comes with it?
Go community college or online cheap. It's not what school you go to. It's what you major in. I mean, if you can get into the Ivy League, cool. You get to play the kiss-ass game. So I'm going to be
You get to have friends who are named Thad and Pennington. Chad and
right,
yes,
the
right.
third.
Field.
Right.
Right. Field. You know, I mean, it's always somebody, right?
Right, right. And you get to play the game of who you are, not what you can do. Hmm. And so, but no, go to get knock out your prereqs at the cheap community college. And, you know, you don't have to go to the flagship campus. Okay. I did this, I forget which book it was, but UW-Madison, Wisconsin, that's the flagship campus.
Yeah, right.
Three times expensive as, I think, Wausau or Platteville. Like, Wausau, Platteville, just satellite campuses in Wisconsin. There's nothing exciting going on.
Same degree, same accreditation.
The same system.
Jesus.
And, you know, you could go for a third of the cost. So get your prereqs out of the way. Then usually you have to go to, like, especially engineering, you're going to have to go to like a campus that offers that.
Of course.
So,
of course.
And then you're going to pay a little bit more. But yeah, you can still do college affordably. And go to school, go to college while you're in high school. Just do that. Get it out of the way.
Here's another question. If Cappy had nephews, what advice would you give them about life, top performer, money, and women? How would Cappy teach his nephews how to be a man and excel in life, not a soy boy?
Oh, that's all? what would I, if I had nephew? It'd be the same thing with my nieces.
Okay.
First, they're little now, so I don't ruin them with, oh, the national debt is this percent of GDP.
Right, just let them be kids.
Just let them be kids and let them be girls and, yeah, let's get candy and I'm going to drop you off at your parents. Bye. But inevitably, they will get older and what I would do is I would teach them money. Now, I'm already starting this now with the little ones is I give them Eisenhower dollars.
Huh.
Or $2 bills.
Okay.
And they're like, what are those? Because in their little hand, they're plates. I mean, they're monstrous. Right. Yeah. And it's a full dollar. Oh, wow. And that gets them interested in money. This is a $2 bill. This is worth two of those. Oh, right. $2. You don't see those. Oh, my goodness. Right, right. So you kind of wet their whistle. You get them excited about that. And then, you know, kind of like I would have them get a job. You know, like, okay, let's sell candy. I'd help them with entrepreneurship.
Okay.
Like, all right, we're going to set up a lemonade stand or whatever. Even if it fails, they kind of learn.
Yeah, right.
You know, shoveling driveways, collecting cans.
Yeah,
like, you know,
odd jobs, babysitting, lawn mowing.
Right, exactly, all that. But then I'd also teach them, all right, well, what if you bought a lawnmower and then you had two lawnmowers and you could go mow there.
There we go.
You could go mow there and then you cut same day. And then, so getting that introduced to them, but then... The education-wise, like, you're not majoring in the liberal arts. You're not majoring in the social sciences. Oh, you're not majoring in culinary arts. You're not. You probably, I'd insist, especially boys, you're getting your ass into the military.
That's right.
Because Drill Sergeant Joe is going to ever live a crap out of
you. He's going to make a man out of you,
yes,
dude.
Yes. And then, you know, just be honest. Show them the numbers. Like, here's the economic data, BLS data. Do you want to be a teacher? They make $35,000 a year and never stop complaining about it. Here's what an engineer makes. Do you want to make, oh, yeah, you make $70,000. Do you know how many toys you can buy with $70,000? So a little bribery. But then as for getting men to be masculine, I mean, it's going to be what I wish I was told. Look, chicks don't give a crap about how kind you are.
That's right.
About your damn politics. I mean, right. They'll say it.
They
go to
care.
The effing gym.
Yeah.
Get strong. Preferably be tall, but if not, you know, do what you can do.
Control your controllables, man.
Right. And then learn to dance. I'd say that'd be another thing.
Yes.
Learn to salsa dance.
There
learn
you
to
go.
Yeah, so that'd be another thing. I cannot emphasize it. You are not, how can I put it? You're the prize.
Yes.
I remember always like, oh my God, it da da da. Like I was somehow tricking the girl to go out
yes.
with me.
Yes.
No, you don't understand. That just she's cute. That's all she is cute.
It. Right.
You don't know if she's in the right field. You don't know if she's nice. You don't know if she's kind. You just think and now you're all it's like, no. And this is where ballroom dancing would come in. Like you can interact with girls. So and then picking girls, like picking the right ones, mm-hmm. like, okay, does she have debt? Is she in IT? Is she a doctor? Is she she's a social justice major? No. So and just being truthful with them. You know, everything we talk about on the Red Pill and
Man.
Like, here's some books. Oh, written by me. There. Oh, wow. You know, I would just not lie to them. Make sure that they hit the gym. Make sure they're not afraid of women.
Yeah.
Get them used to rejection.
Like,
at it. Like, come on. You know, give me the, just so you don't fear anything. And then, absolutely. And then I'd almost like We're doing day game. You ever watch you ever watch Psych?
Oh, yes. Dude, I love that
His
show,
dad.
Man. Oh, my God.
They go back to 1987.
Oh, yeah, you're right. When Corbin Burnson has hair, now you see, son.
I That's love what that I'd stuff. Be doing. Listen, son. I'd be his dad.
Wow, just giving man.
Him, you know, yelling at him. And
sure, right. Everything. And then, right. of course, creating issues, and then dad loses his hair later. Right. But now everybody thinks he's a psychic. He's just incredibly perceptive.
Because his dad trained him.
That's right. Right. That's right. I remember my freshman year, my best friend in college, man. We don't talk anymore. Because of things that have transpired out in Vegas. Mm. But I remember he had his Uncle John come and visit us. He's actually from New Jersey. And so Uncle John came down, and Uncle John was a man's man. He had a beard. He was jacked. And I remember we were all in our little cramped little hole in the wall, you know, apartment or whatever. He's like, you got to remember something, Don. He's like, listen, girls are people too.
Mm-hmm.
And it was so profound because you never really, just like you say, when we're young, seventh, eighth grade, when we start getting boners for girls, we think of them as these otherworldly, heavenly
God-like
beings.
Yes, right.
It's just, oh my God. Uncle John's like, man, listen, they're girls, people too. They burp, fart, and shit just like the rest
and
of us.
They're just as nervous as you yes, on the date of course sometime, they
are. Well, see, here's the thing. It's not like that anymore. Nope. Because, see here, what has happened.
Am I going back to Jeremy Corbyn being my dad?
Yes, now we're going, right, yes. Yeah, now we're see, what has happened now, what has changed about girls is that they're not nervous anymore. And the reason why is because our culture, the girl power movement culture, tells them that boys aren't told that they're the prize when they're little boys, because they're not. You're boys. You haven't learned anything. You're still weak and you don't know anything. Girls are told that they're the prize all the time, directly and indirectly. Mm-hmm. And so we've got girls 13, 14, 15, 16 years old. They're not nervous around guys. They're not nervous around men, because the world tells them, hey, you are it. Mm-hmm. Especially if she's an attractive 19-year-old, she's not nervous around anybody, man. No.
Well, I don't know. I think maybe there was a girl or two way back in the olden days.
That
might have been nervous when I was on a date with her. And I was also nervous. But yeah, I pushed through.
Dude, I remember my first... Oh, my dude. I remember my first kiss, dude. I was...
Really?
Oh, God. I was shaking like a leaf.
Really? How old were you?
14?
Really? 14? Yeah, 14, okay. Yeah. About 13 or something.
Cassandra Harris.
Wow.
Yeah, Cassandra Harris. Yeah. I'll never forget it. Yep. Yeah. It was just the weirdest thing when I think about... See, because when we were younger, that's when, and of course our parents and our grandparents will tell us that the same thing, but I remember it all seemed very natural. You know, boys were nervous about girls. Girls were nervous about boys.
The middle school dance? Like,
yes, right. Yeah. Everybody, the girls are on one, they're on one wall. The guys are on the other. And it was just, and it was a very cool kind of nervous energy.
Yeah.
And I remember I told my friends the next day, guys, I kissed Cassandra Harris. I'm like, what? Are you serious? What happened? One of my friends said, did you get her pregnant? And I'm like,
pregnant?
No. Like, but those are the kinds of conversations that we have had. And I'm sure Cassandra went back and told her friends how bad a kisser I was.
Right, yeah, sure.
Of course, it's not like that anymore, man. We got kids having kids at 13 and 14 years old, man. It's incredible.
I that's one problem that I face is, you know, we're old now.
Yes,
I have to rely on younger guys. Like, give me a field report.
Yeah, what's going on out here? What's going on out here in these streets? Novi 2000, $7, says, great show. I'll be 50 soon with a government retirement of $50,000 a year.
Ooh.
Move to Arizona or Nevada or Tennessee or Florida. Any thoughts on part-time work to supplement a retirement 401k? That's a good question.
If I was, he's a guy.
Yeah, guy. He's going to be 50 soon. Government retirement, man. $50,000 a year. That's not bad.
Yeah, and I'm probably going to do this. I looked into it before. I would join the Reserve Police Force.
Huh.
Or, you know, like they're whatever it's called, reserve or community officers. Depending on where you sign up, you might actually be a sworn officer and can make arrests. Other places, you're just like directing traffic for 4th of
right,
July.
Right.
Because of the camaraderie. I don't think any man can, especially at 50.
No,
I
mean, you gotta have friends.
You gotta have some place to go. And so I think a really good group of guys to go hang out with would be cops, firefighters.
Oh, there we go.
You know, that kind of thing.
Maybe like a volunteer firefighter?
Firefighter. Work at a golf course.
Really?
Work at a cigar lounge, work at a gun range.
Oh, there we go.
All the coolest, oldest dudes I know.
They are doing the coolest things. They're doing the coolest thing.
They're all
and boat. They're chartering boats, right? Taking people fishing.
Well, but then like they all go to like these cigar lounges and whatnot, and so and it's great, man. You walk in to a cigar lounge, whether you're the employee or the customer. Hey, Dick Nuts, what's going on?
That's right.
The knives are out, and here we go. Like, hey, it must be Gay Appreciation Night here. You know, just and it,
is your
like,
dick still as small as it was 2 years ago? Yeah,
you're sucking on something brown and long, like you always. And it's just like, ah, I'm home. Hey, what's that? You know, I belong. And
it's funny. I actually read an article right before I came out here for this show. It was a girl, she had written, it's one of these write-in columns, and she's like, dear, whatever the person's name is, my husband has friends, and they all play video games together, and all they do is make gay jokes. They talk about gay sex, and this is abnormal, and are they homosexual? And the girl's answer was, you might want to get him to seek counseling, because there might be some, and I'm like, are you serious? This is how guys communicate.
So, okay. The GF that I got.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you know Jack Napier?
I do.
Okay.
I do.
So nicest guy ever, right? Nice yes, he kid. Is. He's young and he's out in.
He's a good looking dude. He's I think he's in Holland. Romania or something like
he's
that.
He's somewhere over there. One of the countries Germany invades all the time. So because he's Dutch, he's got that accent.
Yeah.
He can't say his THs. So what I did, and he, for whatever reason, he really looks up to me. It's becoming less that because as he gets to know me, I'm not that really cool. So. He couldn't say TH. So one time he kept saying truth and aloof.
Oh,
and
wow.
So I said, Jack, and I'm like laughing. And the girlfriend's like, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm going to get Jack. So I write this strong, important, almost poetic economic piece.
Okay.
And it had as much THs in it as possible. Truth? Wow. What is truth? Wow. Is it what the soothsayers say? And so he gets it. And I say, Jack, you have a good British accent, and people will take it more seriously than if I read it. He's like, oh, yes, sir, Mr. Clay, right, I'll do it. And then so he reads it, records it online.
Truth.
And then I do a video response to it. I hadn't watched it. Truth. What is truth? Oh. Is it the soof? And I'm just falling over laughing. And my girlfriend's like, that's so mean and cruel. And the guys at Masterly Geeks are laughing. He's like, you dick. And I was just, it's great. Yeah. But no, the girls don't get it. I don't know why it's not that hard. He's just a dick. That's all.
You know, it's interesting. You can always tell. The NBA over the last 10, 15 years has seen an influx of foreign players, European players coming from overseas. And you can always tell, and a lot of them speak very, very little English when they get here, but you play in the league for a little while and, you know, you pick it up, like a little dynamic immersion. And you can always tell. You can always tell a player's been hanging out with brothers, right?
Yeah.
Because when he gets a strong grasp of the English language, it's like some European guy. So, you know, tell me tonight, Darko Milicic, you know, you got out-rebounded by 16 tonight. You know, what's going on? Well, you know what I'm saying? We went to the block, and the coach told us we have to box out, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, I mean, it's like that, you know what I'm saying? And it's like, oh, yeah, yeah, this dude learned to speak English in a locker room.
Yeah.
Whereas for in baseball players, it's not like that. Same thing with, well, most hockey players, I guess, are not American. But I just think it's very funny how you can always tell when someone who isn't from America learned to speak their language.
Yeah, from
like a country
which
accent.
Which locker room did they learn?
Yes, yeah, right, yeah. Exactly. I just find that hilarious. Just to hear some guy whose last name is Milicic, you know what I'm saying? You feel, my
yes,
coach was,
I
said,
you
feel
saying.
Me? I'm like, wow, okay, got it. A couple more questions here. Oh, this is an interesting, let me ask this question first. What is your view? Wow, these are all good questions. What is your view on crypto's place in the current and future market? What would be the best future investments in general?
If I knew what the best future investments would be,
I
would not be here. We'd be on my yacht.
That's right.
Because I'd have so much money. There's no way to know what the future holds. The role I see cryptocurrency playing is, I think, inevitably, it may not be Bitcoin, it may not be Litecoin, but I do believe cryptocurrency will replace what we have as traditional fiat currency.
Okay.
And the reason why, and people are always trying to understand cryptocurrency, and it helps to understand starting from, you know, gold and silver or salt. clams even, and how it evolutionized into pieces of paper backed by silver, now no longer silver. But here's what it really is. Don't view it as things we exchange. Think of it as a record keeping of our time transaction using units of currency, a dollar or a yen. Because when you pay your bills, let's say you cut your check, maybe you don't even cut a check, you don't actually see the money.
Right.
It's just a number on a computer
somewhere. Most of the money that we make, we never physically...
You never physically have. So what that means is our entire currency system, our monetary system, is simply a record keeping operation.
Okay.
And if you look at what goes into keeping accurate records, it's incredibly expensive.
Oh, yeah,
how big, how many, not how big are the banks in terms of sales, but their assets, how many computers, how many employees, how much investment, how much daily effort goes in, how much auditing, how much accounting work, how to make sure that this accounting system.
Wow.
Well,
man.
Cryptocurrency automates all that. And is
really?
Yes. Well, because it's.
Whoa. That I did not know.
Well, but that's what it is. It's blockchain technology. Every transaction is accounted for to the Satoshi or whatever the individual unit is. And now you don't need accountants. You're still going to have accountants to know what kind, how profitable a company is.
This is why banks hate cryptocurrency, Aaron.
This is why.
That's why they hate it. Wow, I never knew.
Now, some countries are trying to come up with their own cryptocurrency, but you have to think of it in this sense. We already kind of have a cryptocurrency.
Okay.
Because the vast majority of our record keeping is digitally done.
That's right.
So this just is a better formula, or not formula, software, or blockchain technology that obsoletes what the current system we have is now. It doesn't get rid of money in the sense like, well, this is a store of value. Like this gold has value, this silver has value, this dollar has value. It's recording Donovan expended X amount of time at this, defined by this many units of a currency on this account, Bitcoin, Litecoin. Aaron paid out to the rental place this many units of his time in the form of Litecoin.
Okay.
And so that is really what we do today and what cryptocurrency does. So I think from that perspective, if the world settles on one, we'll have one global currency. This could be 100 years off.
But that sounds... That actually sounds a lot easier.
You know, yeah, it's less of an accounting nightmare. International transactions.
But now banks are. But now banks are obsolete.
Well, they'll still like. Where do you hold your money or your Satoshi? Well, you'd have your wallet,
crypto wallet, yeah,
crypto wallet. Right. So those would be the kind of the new banks. There'd be banks that want to lend money to do analysis.
Okay.
So there's still going to be a role for financial institutions. But in terms of what it. Beyond that idealistic down the road future technology, I think what it's going to be used as, at least in our lifetime, is a means to export capital out of a country.
Yeah.
I think if a country gets too socialist or too dictatorial or too tyrannical, we're going to tax your wealth. you'll say, by the way, we've locked down your bank accounts.
Oh, God.
I'm Jesus getting Christ. My money out of Venezuela or wherever it is via cryptocurrency.
And
unfortunate, and it's already happened. Vietnam, Venezuela,
You mentioned that earlier. Yeah.
Right. I mean, it's not uncommon where there'll be a lockdown on whatever kind of capital controls a particular country, and cryptocurrency will take a jump up because that's the only way to get your wealth out of the country.
Man, dude.
So that's why I recommend everybody have some cryptocurrency. How much, it's hard to say because it's so volatile, but I like one. I think Modern Life John recommends 2. Joker, he says 10.
What?
Bitcoin. 1 Bitcoin, 2 Bitcoin.
Oh, that's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money.
Because how much is a Bitcoin now?
It's like 15 grand. It went up a lot in the past couple weeks.
Okay.
But, I also say have 200 ounces of silver.
Okay.
And because silver is much more stable. And an ounce of silver is an ounce of silver, ounce of gold, an ounce of gold. Crypto goes like this, so it's kind of like, 15
how, like, grand? And forgive my ignorance. So if you have cryptocurrency, how would you get, see, that's where I'm, and guys, I'm an idiot when it comes to this stuff. How do you get your money out of your Bitcoin wallet? Okay, so you said, I want to get my money out of Venezuela. Cryptocurrency is the way to do that. I couldn't tell, dude, I could open up my Coinbase.
Your cryptocurrency is not in Venezuela.
Okay.
It's on the internet.
Okay, and so how do I get it from the internet into my hand?
You go overseas, where the IP address, you're not being tracked, and you can access your wallet there. Or if they say, we want your, you take your phone, you destroy it, and like, I have no way to access it. You should have been given a 16-word passcode that you should memorize So it's up here in your brain.
Okay.
And then you go overseas, and then you physically open up another wallet, and then you enter in your 16-word passcode.
Is this physically go to another country?
No. No, there's no physical cryptocurrency.
I'm an idiot when it comes to stuff. This fascinates me because I had a consultation with Crypto Charlie. I didn't understand anything he was saying, man.
Let's simplify, because the dollar and the yen, every modern-day currency is technically a cryptocurrency.
Okay.
You go overseas to Europe.
Okay.
Okay, and you got your bank card. Will it work at an ATM there?
Probably not.
Probably will.
Oh, really?
Right. Because where is your money stored?
Yeah, ones and zeros.
Ones and zeros. Right. Now, maybe the computer itself is at the Bank of America or whatever, whoever you bank with, in San Francisco or Philadelphia or wherever.
Sure, right.
But since the cryptocurrency is basically a monstrous record-keeping algorithm, mm-hmm. it's on the internet.
Okay.
I don't know where, this is where I don't know this much about the actual
Somebody
IT
said it's everywhere and nowhere.
Well, it's everywhere and nowhere, but it's somewhere, it's got to be stored somewhere. This record, so there are servers out there. I don't know how they do it. I guess it's like Napster, you know, like you'd have all these computers around the world.
There you go.
It's very akin to that.
Napster.
Where is Peter Gabriel's Sledgehammer song? It's somewhere on some server on the internet
somewhere,
out there.
Yes.
But via Napster or LimeWire.
Great video, by the way. Great video, by the way.
Wonderful, yeah. But if you go, it doesn't matter if you're here or if you're in Tanzania.
Right.
If you download it, you get that information.
Okay.
And so that is how a Bitcoin is, quote, it's stored on the internet, I guess is a simpler way of saying it.
So I have 2 Bitcoin on the internet right now, and I want to get it out. How do I do that?
Well, you access it through your wallet.
Okay.
You go online, you log in, and then you can, but then you have to convert it into something to, quote, get it out.
Right.
So you have to go through, what's Coinbase? I forget the name of it. Not an exchange. A brokerage. It's basically a brokerage account.
Okay.
Coinbase is I forget the official term. But like, I want to get my stocks. I want to sell my IBM shares.
Okay.
You have to sell it through a brokerage and then get cash.
Okay.
Coinbase or other brokerages that only specialize in cryptocurrency will do that. So you redeem, you find someone who wants to buy your cryptocurrency, your Bitcoin through Coinbase. Coinbase matches up the buyers and the seller. It takes, I think, a little bit of a commission. And then you have to tell Coinbase or whoever you dedicate as your
brokerage
mm-hmm. to put it into this bank account in the form of dollars.
Okay. Yeah. Wow. So, and how long does that take?
Instantaneously. There's enough volume now.
Wow. Yeah.
Now it could change though. Like it's an issue of liquidity. How many shares are being traded at any particular moment in time?
Yeah, that's true. Because if they're all being traded, then.
Well, that's good. That means there's a lot of volatility. That means there's someone in the market.
Okay.
So like if you look at trading volume in the stock market, like IBM, you know, I don't know, 100 million shares or a billion shares.
Yeah, something like that.
That's more than ample transactions that you will have no problem finding a buyer for your IBM
shares. Okay, so I will never not be able to pull my money out of.
Well, what if Bitcoin falls out of favor for whatever reason and there's very few people trading it, like no one's selling it or no one's buying it? So that's another issue of liquidity. So you can have markets dry up where there's no volume and no trading. But I think there's enough people trading in Bitcoin today. Some of those weird ones, like there's over 1,500 cryptocurrencies
right
now.
Oh, my God, I know.
You can't even find a buyer for your douche coin or whatever the heck people are coming up with. You know, but Bitcoin, Litecoin, Ethereum, those have enough volume that you should be able to find yourself a buyer or a seller more or less immediately.
Man, that is incredible, man. Because I'm always... I get very uncomfortable when, not uncomfortable, because this is kind of the norm. I don't like it when my money is ones and zeros, man. I'm that old school guy. I like to have my jars of money. I like to put my money in my safe. I like to be able to see and feel my money, but it's 2020, mm-hmm. man. And I just don't like when I want access to my money, I want access to it. I don't want to have to, I've got an appointment with a bank, on Monday, mm-hmm. A business bank account that allows me to access the money that I freaking earn, mm-hmm. right? It just seems like there are financial institutions that just make it so difficult. Like they have no problem depositing the money, mm-hmm. but then when you want to get it out or you want to spend it, it's always, well, wait a minute, what are you using for? It's my fucking money.
Right.
I can use it for whatever the hell I want.
Right. Well, if you want physical money, you know, and we could talk dollars, but again, it's record keeping. They're just saving the money, unless you're gonna like buy a house. That's another way you have a house, so you got property.
Right.
But if this is where precious metals come in, and if you want to own, you know, this is where coin collecting maybe is a fun little hobby to make it interesting.
Okay.
You could buy somebody a lot of jewelry, And then you can wear the money.
Yeah, you just can wear it. Yeah. Just dollar bills around your...
Well,
around
no,
your...
like gold and silver jewelry.
Oh, wow.
Jewelry is... Now, of course, you lose at least 25% of your value because a lot of craftsmanship goes into it.
Right, right.
But yeah, I mean, people buy jewelry, and that's that's a means of holding value.
Okay, so. I like that. Retired, 2019, $10, says, good show. I'm 58, divorced, and retired with a pension. Should I consider getting remarried or remain single for life? Happily retired. What?
He's what retired?
He's 58 and retired. He wants to know if he should get married
again. What kind of retired is he?
He is retired with a pension.
And keep reading.
Okay. So he's considering getting married. No, he's divorced.
All right. And that keep the last two sentences.
Yes, he said, should I consider getting remarried or remain single for life?
And?
Happily retired.
Happily retired.
There you go.
How about we keep it that way and you don't get married?
Dude, what are we... Listen, man, I understand the need for companionship.
Right.
But you're 58 and retired. Dude, you can have companionship without all of the paperwork, right?
Marriage is so obsolete.
It's a farce.
And such an unnecessary risk. I'm not saying don't have fun. If you're in the right state, cohabitate. Yeah. I'm not saying don't commit.
Right.
There is no effing reason to bring the government along with a ton of legal liability.
God. Oh my God.
And there's just no reason. None.
Okay. And all right. You have your answer. Nope. Retired 2019. Let's make sure we stay unmarried. Married. Yeah.
Or happily retired.
Yes. Happily retired and happily unmarried. C-Dub, $5, says men bond over good-natured ball busting. Women have no balls, which is why most of them don't get it. Not bad, just an inherent gender difference. Very, very, very clever question. A couple more questions here. This is a good one. If and when the dollar does collapse, where is the best to be when it happens?
I don't know. That's what I'm doing next year, 2021. I'm doing 2 4-month trips. Winter, I'm going to be going down to Southeast Asia and scoping out places to live.
Okay.
In case this actually happens.
Yeah, yeah.
And doing some quick analysis using economics. I like the Baltics.
Okay.
Although that's not Southeast Asia. Thailand, the Philippines, Singapore, if you can afford it. That would be the goal. Malaysia is actually pretty nice. Okay. That's doing pretty well. If you want to get off the beaten path, New Caledonia is kind of interesting. I don't know if I'm going to go there, but just as according to the numbers. Dubai, although that's transient.
Is transient, but it is inexpensive to live, and it's a nice place.
It's a nice place, and then going back to Central Europe, and you know, I'm going to be looking at the former Soviet bloc countries because they, you know, some of them outlaw communism.
Right.
I'm not even necessarily going for communism. I'm going for cultural stability.
Okay.
So, you know, if I show up, will the gas pumps work? You know,
yes.
If I ask for borscht, will I get borscht?
Yes.
You know, wherever
if
I am.
If you're in Ukraine, right?
Yeah. So, but that I will be announcing my results when I find things and do a little bit more traveling.
Okay.
If he's real interesting, you go to a Sovereign Man and Nomad Capitalist. Those are two guys who specialize in that.
Okay, very good. Last question. Can Cappy come clean about his addiction to poke bowls and redheaded strippers?
Strippers are dumb, man.
Oh, God.
That is the dumbest thing ever.
Dude.
Poke bowl is awesome. You ever have poke bowl?
No, what is it?
It's like sushi in a bowl. And it's very healthy for you.
What?
Yeah, so like you can get whatever you want, like tuna and some eel.
I love tuna.
And it's the same ingredients as sushi, but usually there's a rice base, but you can get quinoa.
A poke bowl. Let me look that up.
You're guaranteed. They got to be out here.
Oh, of course. Yeah. I mean, we're in New Jersey now, but poke bowl. I got to look this up.
P-O-K-E.
Oh, look at that poke bowl near me. Wow. So there are 1, 2, 3. There are all... There's like 25 poke bowl places out here. Wow.
It's great, yeah. And so it's healthy and it's a little pricey. And what a lot of cool guys on my show do, if they donate money, they'll donate like, here's for the poke bowl fund. And it's cool because then in lunch, I go and I get my poke bowl.
There you go. Yeah. Proof of, those look good.
Yeah, they're healthy too.
Those look very good. Yeah, basically it kind of just is sushi in a bowl. That looks very appetizing.
You get some wasabi and...
clear up the sinuses real quick.
Oh,
huh?
Yeah. No, it's
tough. Well, listen, Aaron, this was fun, man. I definitely learned a lot. I would love to pick your brain about this whole Bitcoin thing, because I know a lot of people there are some guys out there, Bitcoin is the god, it's the way right. to go. And then there are some people who are a little bit more realistic about it. But I like the freedom, or at least the appearance of freedom that Bitcoin gives you, to be able to have it in this. It's volatile, but nobody else can touch it.
Right.
Like nobody, the government, nobody can go in there and just, not your banking institution, nobody can go in there and take your Bitcoin from you. And if you want to pull it out, if you want to liquidate it, you can do that anytime you want to. Mm-hmm. How much, what percentage, like how many Bitcoin should a man have?
Well, I would say one.
Okay.
Ideally.
Okay.
See, but it also depends on its price, you know, because like
sure.
If back when it was below a buck or whatever, yeah, go get 1,000, you know.
Yeah, but what is it now? If you got 1,000, you're
15,000.
Yeah, right. Yeah, well, yeah, right.
Yeah, so you're doing pretty well. So I say one. Again, Modern Life John says two. I think Joker says 10 or 10. Ideally, you would have 10 Bitcoin. That, okay. I guess, is more like a long-term goal.
Yeah, that's 150 large.
Yeah, that's a lot. I'd almost say like, okay, you got enough. You know, you could that probably
would,
invest
in other things.
It would scare
me. You know? That, well, I don't know. That would scare me to have that much tied up in that, because...
And I would say I wouldn't have 150,000 in Bitcoin. I'd have 50,000 Bitcoin, 50,000 whatever, Ethereum, 50,000, whatever the top five cryptocurrencies are, because okay. you want to diversify across those cryptocurrencies.
Oh, so it's the same concept as investing.
Oh yeah, because okay. what if whatever algorithm, there's a flaw in Ethereum's blockchain.
Yeah.
What if there wasn't that? And then that goes down. All right, now you just lost it. Or if you get, however it gets hacked, I don't know. This is where my knowledge is limited, because I don't know the programming and
yeah,
the IT
yeah,
aspect.
Right, right.
But it just, as an economist, they're just common sense. It's like, well, I don't want to invest in, you know, all my money in U.S. steel. I would invest in Bethlehem steel.
Okay.
And Cotai steel, or whatever other steel companies are out there. But yeah, I'd say one, two is better, but boy, 10, you better have some other assets.
Yeah. You can't have 100% of your assets tied up in anything.
No, not
so that's, yeah. Listen, if you have 10 Bitcoin, then you need to have 50 Bitcoin in other areas, okay. I suppose. Atham Aldikua.
He's just $2. A nobody. Don't you can ignore him.
He's funny. It's a cute little dog. Aaron, listen, man. Thanks for coming out, man. Like I said, this was a lot of fun. I think we learned a lot. Guys, subscribe to what camera is on? Are we on the slider here, Dev? Main. Oh, main. Guys, subscribe to Aaron's channel. He does good work. You're right around 60,000 subscribers now, right? You're over
yeah.
now.
Yeah, 64, yeah. 65 now. 60,
yeah,
YouTube,
see, yeah. Wow, okay. So you'll be at 100,000 subscribers if YouTube ever fixes their algorithm. listen, he's written fascinating books. Oh, my God, dude. Reconnaissance Man, Bachelor Pad Economics. You guys definitely need to check them all out. We're going to put them all in the links to this the description in this video. I think this one is going to stay up.
Okay.
I think this one is going to stay up.
We cursed at all.
No, we probably maybe once or twice, but I don't see this having to be taken down. So I think this will stay up. Aaron, thank you very much
for
joining us,
Donovan.
And we're going to go and have a steak, and we'll call it a day. Yeah. All right. Peace out.